We will now transition into the fourth part of our lecture, which goes over a few other flip-flop implementations just to show you how they are built and what they can solve. So, as a problem that we didn't discuss, there's the problem of clock overlap. This is our multiplexer-based flip-flop, and we see that there's this inverter on the clock path because we need both clock phases in order to open up and close the transmission gates. Well, what happens is that the clock bar, it's the inverted clock, clock B over here, is delayed a bit by the TPD of this inverter from the original clock. Usually, we'll put this clock inverter inside the actual flip-flop to make the this transition as short as possible and as close and local as possible and not have a lot of skew between the two signals. But still, there is some sort of an area where we have this overlap between the two, and either they'll both be positive or both be negative at the same time. When both of them are positive or both of them are negative, what happens is we actually get the situation where both the transmission gate at the entrance, at the input to the flip-flop, and at the output to the flip-flop are open at the same time. And then we have a feed-through path from D to Q, making this behave as a latch for this short period of time. That is something that we do not want. And there comes in several flip-flop designs that try to solve this problem. And the most well-known one is called C2MOS, or clocked CMOS. So clocked CMOS, C2MOS, is insensitive to clock overlap. Down here we have the waveforms of these overlapping clocks. Here we have the implementation of the C2MOS type of a flip-flop. And what we can basically see here is that we just used a tri-state buffer instead of a standard inverter on the C2MOS path. And basically what that does is if we connect the clock and clock bar oppositely, we have a dynamic type of a latch where we put our latch into tri-state and the master stage during one clock edge, and the other, the slave stage, we put into its opaque and closed tri-state position in the other phase. So let's see that work. So basically, if we have an overlap on the low phase, what happens here is that we make a situation where we cannot have a feed-through path. Okay, so right now we have a low phase overlap, and that means that both clock and clock bar are low. if clock is low, then this M4 transistor is on, which enables a path to charge up the capacitance on X. So we can have, if we had a zero on X before this occurred, and there was a transition from D going up from one down to zero, it will actually charge up X, even though we're not supposed to have any feed through here because this is a flip-flop and it's only supposed to sample on the rising edge of the clock. However, when that happens, so X was charged now, as you can see, since clock is at zero and it is connected to the transistor over here, M7, there is no path that enables us to discharge Q, which would cause a transition on Q. So even though X, the internal node, does change in this case, Q does not change, and that means that there is no feed through of the signal. On the other hand, if D was 0 and it changed to 1, there is no path because M3 is turned off. There is no path to discharge X. So we have solved the low phase problem. How about the high phase problem? Well, in the high phase problem, a similar thing happens. So again, we have no problem if we go from a 1 to a 0 on the input, because since clock now is at 1, M4 is off, and we have no path to charge X, so we can't feed through this 1 to 0 transition. But what about the 0 to 1 transition? Well, that will turn on M1, and since M3 is on, we can discharge, in this case, the X. However, discharging the X would then open up M6 and supposedly charge up Q. However, since clock bar is at 1, M8 is off. And so this actually solves our problem that both during low phase overlap and high phase overlap, there is no situation where we can feed through a change on the input to the output. So clock CMOS is a popular type of a flip-flop that was used mainly by IBM. It's not very commonly found today. One of the reasons being it's a dynamic type of a circuit. We don't have have static holdabilities on the internal or the X or the Q, the internal or the external nodes. However, you can add all kinds of things like a bleed transistor or a feedback transistor to actually enable it to become static. And again, this was used by IBM for quite a while in their processors. I'm not sure if they still use them today, but it was popularized by them. However, it still has this overlap type of a thing, and we still need to make a clock and a clock bar have two phases inside our flip-flop, and that is where a TSPC or a true single phase clocked register comes into play. And this was a pretty cool invention that allows us to really use just one single clock edge. We only use one clock. We don't need the clock bar. And let's see how it's made. Actually, we have these two latches, a positive latch and a negative latch, and we need six transistors to make each of these latches. And it's actually pretty clear. So we just put a transistor here in the pull down of this buffer. We have two inverters that are cascaded with an enable type of a transistor in the middle. And when clock is one, these are just standard inverters. And so obviously we have this path that lets us feed through from in to out, just like we would expect in any latch. However, once clock goes to zero, we block off the ability of the transistor to work. Now, again, with a tri-state buffer, we would need two transistors, one over here and one up above, as we saw before in the C2 MOS type of a flop. But that would, first of all, need the other clock edge. And second of all, it would cost us another transistor. Here, all it does is it cuts off the pull-down path, but we still have the pull-up path. But luckily, since we cascaded another inverter on top of it, we have no pull-down path from the second stage. So if we pull up the internal node, we still can't pull down the output. And so therefore, it is blocked during the case where clock is zero. We cannot make any changes. So we were able to make a true single phase clocked latch in this case. So this is a TSPC latch, and just moving the inverter above just moving the enable transistors above the internal node turns it into a negative latch. So if we use PMOSes here instead of NMOSes. Another real nice thing about this is that what we can see here is all we have basically is an inverter here and an inverter here with a pull up and a pull down. Well, we can actually go over and change the logic so it's not an inverter, but rather some sort of another CMOS gate. So we can replace the single pull up over here with a whole pull up network and the single pull down with a whole pull down network. And we created a latch that has a logic built inside, saving quite a bit of area and making pretty cool stuff. So here you can see an AND latch, and it's an AND because this is non-inverting, right? We have two inverters cascaded, so it's a buffer. But by just putting in one and in two inside this guy and having the second stage as a similar kind of to domino logic as an inverter, we have a NAND followed by an AND, and it's all built into a latch, and we were able to cause this ANDing latch with very few transistors. In fact, all we have here is eight transistors to make that. Now, what about a flip-flop? Well, a flip-flop requires cascading a master and a slave stage, but doing it, we can actually save some transistors by kind of overlapping the two. So a TSPC flip-flop in this case, it takes one of these negative type of latches, and it follows it by a kind of a enabled with both sides type of a circuit, and then followed by what is more like a positive latch. And this thing works out as a flip-flop that only has one single clock phase. So there is only clock. There is no clock bar in this thing. It is not sensitive to overlap, and it actually works with very few transistors as well. So here we have 3, 3, 3. That's 9 transistors. And if we count the buffer at the end or the inverter to have it non-inverting and have it have a good drive strength, then we're talking about 11 transistors for a whole flip-flop. So this is one of the type of true single-phase flip-flops that has been that has been proposed in literature. And the thing works. It's not very popular. Again, most of us are using these very static standard mux-based latches, maybe some sort of a C2 type mux-based latch. So we can have muxes that have tri-state inverters inside. But in any case, we'd be using a real static non-ratioed latch instead of one of these guys. But they are other options to look into. A further way to do it and reduce the complexity in some way and make the complexity larger in another way is what I mentioned before as pulse-triggered latches. So we saw that a latch is transparent during one of the clock phases and opaque during the other one. And usually we need two of those latches, a negative one and a positive one, to make a master-slave type of a flip-flop that is edge sensitive. But instead, we conceptually could just take a single latch, which is basically half of this master-slave type of flip-flop, and instead of connecting a clock which with a 50% duty cycle to it, connect a clock with a very short duty cycle, say like 5% or something, give it a pulse, a small pulse, and only during that small pulse we would have this D to Q path operational. And on the falling edge, we're going to be sampling what's at the input. And since this falling edge samples the input and the falling edge comes right after the rising edge, we in fact get an edge sensitive flip-flop. It's sensitive to the pulse, not the edge, but the pulse comes at the rising edge of the clock, and so it's a rising edge flip-flop, and this saves us quite a bit of area, and it's actually a pretty cool type of a thing. It does come with its problems. How do you propagate that pulse to all the registers in a robust way? And it's not very trivial, but this is an approach that is used in some places. Another question is, how do you make a pulse? And I just haven't discussed this before, so I wanted to show you here what a clock chopper is. And it's a simple idea, and there are many ways to do this, but the basic idea usually is to take the clock and take a delayed version of the clock, and the delay version may be buffered or it may be inverted. In this case, we took an inverted version and drove it into a NAND gate. Okay, so what happens here is that when the clock goes up, we have, for a long time, we had a zero over here at the input. And so the zero was over here. And here, since it was inverted, it was a one. And since we had a zero and a one, we had a one at the output and a zero over here. Correct? That is the way we started. Now there's a transition. So this goes from zero to one over here at the clock edge, right? And this goes immediately, rises to one. But when that happens, there's a delay here through this chain of inverters. And in the meantime, we have 1-1 at the input to the NAND. And that means this goes down to 0. And this goes up to 1. Okay? So the output actually rose to 1, as you can see here. But after this short delay, this TPW delay, this guy goes down to 0. And now we have 1-0, which again raises this to 1. And lowers this to 0. So after this TPW, the input goes down, and what we got is a short pulse. You can use different options of NAND gates, NOR gates, XOR gates, inverting or non-inverting delays, and they can give you negative pulses or different types of duty cycles and so forth. But this is how we make a clock chopper. This is how we create a pulse in many different applications.